beautiful camellias next on Gardener's Hotline. Welcome to Gardener's Hotline. I'm your host, Karen Stauderman, a University of Florida Horticulture Extension agent. Today's program celebrates camellias. They have been a part of our southern landscape for almost 200 years. Native to the Orient, they were introduced to the United States in 1786. In Florida, camellias flower in the fall and winter, just when we need the color most. There are over 3,000 cultivars and hybrids, and it ranks as one of the most popular winter flowering shrubs in the world. Our guest today works in the commercial production of camellias, as well as other nursery plants. Let's welcome back to the show Bill Bodnarik from John's Nursery in Eustace. Hi, Bill. Welcome back.
Hi, Karen. It's good to be here tonight. Thank you, and I'm excited to talk about camellias
tonight. Oh, great, because I got a lot of people at home that have questions. So I'd like to remind our viewers at home that this is a call-in show, so pick up the phone and give us a call. What this number, it's 1-800-901-9238. Well, let's get started, Bill. Since you've been here last, tell us a little bit about what goes on at John's Nursery.
At John's Nursery, we grow container landscape ornamentals on 200 acres of land in Eustace and Lake County, just down the road. John and Rita Rackley started the nursery in 1972, and they... John was right out of college, and he wanted to be a farmer. He got into the business when he was in high school down in Hialeah. And he and Rita bought land in Lake County in Eustace and planted the first twigs themselves. And since then, in the 42 years since, the nursery has grown to 200 acres.
Wow, that's quite a bit. Now, how many people work for them?
We have about 75 people that work in the nursery.
Is it a family-run operation?
It's a family-run operation. John and Rita are still active in the business every day. And the next generation is coming along. Many of the employees feel like family. I myself have been there 30 years this week.
Wow.
So it's just a great place to be. And we're surrounded by all this beauty.
So what's it like every day there? What goes on?
Well, we self-propagate our plants. We take our own cuttings. We germinate our own seed. And we grow a variety of landscape ornamentals for the South. We'll talk about camellias today. We also grow the roses. We grow broadleaf evergreen plants for the Florida landscape, ligustrums, pittosporums, azaleas, things like that. Also evergreens like junipers and upright junipers. We also have ground covers, daylilies, the border grasses, and things like that. We ship throughout Florida and throughout the southeast, on up to North Carolina, and then in an arc through Atlanta and down to New Orleans.
Wow. How far south do you ship?
We do ship to Miami on the East Coast and Naples on the West Coast, yes.
Now, do camellias grow pretty well in South Florida?
Camellias, we like to say, if you draw a line from Vero Beach on the East Coast to Sarasota on the West, then from that point north is the best area to grow camellias. Now, sasanquas can grow further south as container plants.
How many different type of varieties of camellias do you have?
Oh, my goodness. We have 25, 26 varieties of japonica varieties, and we'll talk about the different varieties and the attributes of each of the types of camellias, but japonica varieties are a primary subset of camellias. We have about 25 or 26 varieties, and about 10 or 12 varieties of sasanquas, which is the second major subset of camellias that we'll talk about today.
Okay, and what's your favorite between the two?
Oh, my goodness, it depends. You know, we have some beautiful japonicas, and we have some beautiful sasanquas.
I can't
name a favorite. It's almost like picking a favorite child.
Well, let's start with some of our varieties that we have here. And the first one I'd like to talk about is the one you have to the right. Tell us a little bit about that variety.
Okay, we'll talk about japonica camellias and japonicas, and this is a good representative. This variety is called Daikagura. Japonicas are tree forms where they're native in China and southern Japan. They can grow up to 40 feet tall, some of them.
Wow, how long does it take for them to get to be 40 feet tall?
Decades.
Wow.
It takes a while because they're not particularly fast growing plants.
And that's in Florida too? It'll take decades?
It can take decades in Florida. So as far as a landscape plant, it'll be a nicely sized landscape plant. From the nursery, when you first buy it, it may be 2.5 to 3 feet tall. And in 15 years, and maybe 10 or 12 feet tall.
Okay.
So it's going to take a while to reach maximum height. If your viewers are interested in seeing mature camellias to their full height, the Lou Gardens in Orlando, they have some beautiful specimens that are just huge. So this variety is Dichogora. Like I said, it's a Japonica type. Camellia flowers, the color ranges from white to pink and into red. And we do have variegated forms, and this is a beautiful example of a variegated form of flower.
And what gives it the variegation?
Years ago, camellias were infected with a benign virus, a friendly virus that causes a color break or a variegation. You'll see variegation in the leaves, which is not necessarily particularly attractive. It's not ugly, but it's not what you would buy a camellia for. But the beauty is the effect of the virus on flower color. The parent form of Dichogora is probably a pink, and with the virus, it causes the variegation, and it's not a consistent variation, so you get a slightly different color pattern with every flower.
It's stunning.
No, it is stunning. It's beautiful.
We have Sean from Ormond Beach. Hi, Sean. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Bill today?
Hi, I have a very mature camellia plant, about 10 feet tall. I was wondering how to basically get a cutting off.
What a good question. He wants to get a cutting off a 10-foot camellia tree. What do you recommend?
Okay. I have clippers here, and let me demonstrate with this plant right here.
Sure.
We propagate our own camellias. We do tens and tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of cuttings from all the varieties of camellias that we grow. We take the recently hardened off spring growth, and that would be a time frame late June, early July, where the wood is firm and the bark is slick, and we'll take a cutting about this size. It's about 4 to 5 inches long. Strip off the lower leaf or two. Now, we do use a rooting hormone.
Okay.
You can get a powdered preparation or liquid preparation. We use liquid preparations in the nursery, and we dip the cutting in a rooting hormone, and we stick the cutting. Again, it's June or July. We use an intermittent mist. You have to have a mist system for these camellias. It'll take 8 to 12 weeks to strike root and for the roots to grow, so this cutting becomes self-sustaining.
And it's sterile soil?
It's a commercial potting mix that can be bought at garden centers.
And it's,
or big
what's
boxes.
The mixture of it? Some peat, some perlite?
We mix our own. It's Canadian peat and perlite with some micronutrients and a little bit of fertilizer. And dolomite. So after about 12 weeks, the cuttings are removed from the mist house, and we call the next stage a liner. And this is a liner, and this is pretty much what we start with here.
Wow.
So from this point to a full-grown plant is about 3 years.
Okay, so then probably by late summer, early fall, you're starting to transplant those in larger pots?
It can be done there, but I find that camellias do best when they're actively growing. And when you get to the end of the growing season in August and September, they're not wanting to do their thing. So normally I hold them over until they're actively growing again.
So how long have these been in this tray?
These were stuck in probably late June, early July.
Of this year?
Of this year, right. So they rooted through the summertime. They were removed from our propagation area, our intensive, our neonatal intensive care unit, which is which is what I call our propagation area.
Right.
And then I let them harden off through the wintertime. We do fertilize them lightly, and then we prep them for spring when we plant them.
So that's about 8 months calendar time. Now with your fertilizer, is mm-hmm. your fertilizer, like you said, is it a liquid?
We will use a liquid on the liners, but when we're growing the larger size containers, Karen, like this 3 gallon container, we soil incorporate a slow release, a timed release fertilizer. It's a plastic coated fertilizer that actually lasts a full year.
And can everybody get a hold of this, or is it only commercial?
There are slow release products that the garden at the independent garden centers and the big box garden centers. Yeah, I don't know if they have the 1 year release curve, but you can do the same thing with a 3 to 4 month type fertilizer or a 5 to 6 month type fertilizer. You know, by just keeping track. Camellias are not heavy feeders either in the landscape or in containers. So you want to go on the low end of the fertilizer recommendations.
Okay. I can't get over on how many buds you have on these cuttings, and they're only 8 months old.
Well, this leads us to the next camellia that we're going to talk about.
And that's this one?
Yes. This is Shishi Gushera.
Oh.
And this is a wonderful plant. Now, we spoke earlier of a japonica variety, a small tree. This is a Sasanqua variety. And Sasanquas are like the other camellias. There's a lot of attributes that make Sasanqua camellias just wonderful landscape plants. They're hardy in the landscape. They can tolerate a range of conditions. Sasanquas can take full sun. It's not a thing that a lot of gardeners know. Japonicas, you talk about the plants needing filtered sun or some shade. Sasanquas can take full sun, so they can be used throughout the landscape. Shishi Gushera is a wonderful plant. It comes into flower in late October, early November. It gives you a 2.5-3 month flower show.
Wow.
A lot of flower buds. You know, you can see the liners are just loaded with flower buds. Individual flowers last 4 to 5 days. Okay. If we have some rainy weather, it kind of beats the flowers up a little bit. But there's plenty of buds, new buds open, and the flower show continues. The habit of Shishi Gushera is a mounding habit. It may finish at about 4 feet tall. That takes 10 years, 12 years. And then that tall and about 6-7 feet across.
So, now, explain to the viewers what mounding means.
Mounding, let me see. It grows a certain height, and then it's round.
Okay, so okay, it just cascades
yeah.
over.
It's not upright. It's cascading over. Yes.
All right, the japonica is more upright.
Japonicas in general are more upright, yeah. Some Sasanquas are mounding. Some Sasanquas are upright as well, okay? So, but in the case of Shishi Gushera, it's a mounding habit. Its use could be along a berm, along a foundation. It's a great plant for that. Indian hawthorn is a real common landscape plant in Florida. This could be used in place of Indian hawthorn. It gives you a flower show throughout the fall and into early winter. The flowers are 3 inches across in this rosy magenta color.
But I have to say, the japonica sure gives a bigger flower and a much more ostentatious look there.
They do, but you know, that doesn't mean that you have to choose one over the other.
That's true. You can have both.
Exactly.
Now, where does John's Nursery get their stock at? Where do you get your original mother plants to make the cuttings?
The original mother plants. Well, we brought these in years ago, but I do have a variety, and let me set this one aside because
okay.
I'm going to point out one behind me here, Karen. This is a newer one that we got. This is called Early Autumn.
Now that's a serious flower.
This is a serious flower. The flower forms in camellias. There's singles, there's doubles, there's semi-doubles, informal doubles. This is a formal double, and this is exquisite.
It is. It's beautiful.
Exquisite. Now this is a recent addition to our price list. There's hobbyists around the country that breed plants. There's a serious hobby a group with camellias, and they're breeding and looking for plants for their own uses. We try to find the ones that have good horticultural attributes. Japonicas normally flower January to March timeframe, early autumn, like the name implies. Flowers with Sasanquas, it's early, meaning it's November, December timeframe. Has a beautiful flower, what's that, about 5 inches across?
Yes.
This pink color. So we picked this up from, we didn't get it directly from the hobbyist, but we got it from an early adopter.
Now, is it consistently like that? Every time
it
you
is.
Do cuttings, it's going to look that way?
That's right. Yeah, cuttings is known as asexual propagation, cloning.
Right.
So the cuttings are genetic duplicates of mom.
Now you guys don't breed down there, do you? You don't cross-pollinate?
No, we don't. We have enough to do growing.
I was gonna say you guys plenty of free time down there, Bill. Now come on.
Karen, you pointed this one out a little bit earlier. This is another Sasanqua variety. This one's called Mini no Yuki, or snow on the mountain is its Japanese translation.
Wow, it's pretty.
And again, this is a Sasanqua. This has a mounding habit. This will grow about 5 to 6 feet tall and about 6 feet across. It's white flowered. It can take full sun. It can take partial or like filtered shade, which would be like pine shade. You know, you don't want to put these under heavy oak shade per se. But again, this is a, you know, these are tough, durable landscape plants that do well in our viewing area in Central Florida.
And they're evergreen, so the leaves won't drop.
Evergreen. And part of the beauty of these too, some of these may be, you know, when they come into flower, they may be hard to match colors with other types of things that you want to do. When you come into this time of year, there's not as much color in the landscape, so there's not as much clashing going on.
Oh, okay.
So you get a big burst of color from camellias. You know, you don't have to necessarily worry about you know, the bedding plants that you might want to put in the springtime
right.
with the different colors and causing a color clash. So
we have Carmel on the line. Hi, Carmel. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Hi.
Go ahead with your question.
My question is, I have a camellia, and its leaves have got a white powdery appearance, and when you move off the powder, there are little black mites on the leaf. I have tried everything and anything, both the roots and to the leaves, and I can't control it. I'm wondering, is it because it's since 1980 and it's getting old?
Bill, we know what she's talking about.
Know what she's talking about, and I have a sample of it right here, the scourge of camellias.
Yes.
The scourge of camellias. And it's something that I deal with in the nursery as well. And what's for me as a commercial nurseryman, what's turned this around? We used all manners of insecticides to try to take care of this problem. Never had much success. But commercially, a product that's called an insect growth regulator, you know, came on the market for me. And I've pretty much been able to eliminate this problem. Unfortunately, those products are not available to the homeowner. This problem is called T-scale. And it's a white powder like the woman described. On the back, if you rub it, you'll see the bodies of the scale insect. If you look closely, you'll see the juveniles, which are kind of lemon yellow color. If you view from the top, the scale pierces and sucks the plant juices from the leaves. That results in yellow stippling on the upper side of the leaves. So what would be available to the homeowner would be a tree and shrub type systemic material that could be applied on the ground around the leaf drip area of the shrub. There's horticultural oils that can be obtained from independent
right.
garden centers or big box stores.
Commercial applicators, too, could do that, couldn't they? Can they get their hands on that growth regulator?
I don't know that, Karen.
Okay.
I don't know that. The beauty of the insect growth regulator is just 4 times a year application, and it's not a toxin. I mean, it's not a poison.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So it's, you know, so it really fits into the program well. When the camellia grows too dense or it's up against other plants or it's up against a building, that sheltered environment allows the scale to flourish.
Sure.
So selective pruning to open up the foliage a little bit would help. It won't eliminate the problem, but it'll help. If the foliage is pressed up against the building, just pruning a little bit to encourage air movement will help the problem. But look for the tree and shrub type products. Horticultural oils work well because they smother the insect.
Sure.
The problem with that is you have to cover every part of the leaf surface, which is really right. difficult to do. It was a tough problem for decades for us, and these insect growth regulators came out about 10 years ago, and it's really made the problem, you know, go away for
right.
us.
And
unfortunately,
so,
it's not available to homeowners.
So we recommend that you follow the label rate and
always.
For rate and frequency, and of course for protective equipment. We have Bill from Georgetown on the line. Hi, Bill. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Thank you. Yeah, I have a red camellia to start with, and it morphed into a pink one, and I was wondering if there's a way to get it to turn back red again, if you know any secrets. Thank you.
Oh, my.
Is that common?
It's not particularly. I would need to know the environment of the plant.
Is it sporting, or does it respond to a pH?
It may be a heavy shade issue.
Okay.
I have had color mutations develop, but usually it's a branch. You know, it's a branch that develops, not the whole plant per se.
Right.
It doesn't necessarily respond to fertilizer type. That's a tough question. That would need a little bit more investigation. If the caller would like to email you and...
Sure, a photograph. Bill from Georgetown, why don't you email me a photograph and I'll give you the email at the end of the program and we can forward that on to Bill and we can put our heads together and see what's going on.
I need to dig into that one a little bit more.
That's interesting. Yeah, okay. My goodness. All right, well, tell me a little bit about some of the other varieties that you have in front. And also, what time of year do you prune, just in general, that you recommend in the nursery just to bring them down to size? What's the best time of year in Florida?
Okay, let me talk about the pruning. Okay. No, right off. Camellias set flower buds on spring growth as it hardens off. So that means June, July, and early August. But I pretty much don't prune camellias hard, you know, to remove the, you know, that growth after July. Because if you do prune at, you know, past that point, you'll be cutting off flower buds.
Okay, so they have to do it before... right after winter, but before June.
That's right. If you want to do a structural prune, I mean a major pruning on camellias, first off, you don't want to prune camellias too hard. They're not tolerant plants of pruning. Prune to shape. When you begin to see the buds swell, when you begin to see active growth in the springtime, which is usually in Central Florida, April 1st to the April 15th time frame, that's when we do our major structural pruning on camellias.
What about North Florida viewers?
Florida viewers, I would, you know, a week or two later, but watch your plants. You know, plants do talk to you, so you need to be looking for the signs. When you begin to see the vegetative buds begin to swell and begin to grow, that's the best time to prune for a couple reasons. First off, you're not, you know, you don't run the risk of pruning off the flower buds because the growth hasn't formed yet. Secondly, you're helping the plant, or you're directing the plant where to make the new growth. Okay, if you allow those buds to grow, then those buds are going to grow where they will. If you do the pruning just as those buds are beginning to swell, you can direct the plant the way you want it to grow, and then, and then watch results happen. So, you know, right around that April 1st, in the spring of 2014, spring came a little bit earlier, so we were pruning earlier in March. But just watch the plants and watch for that bud formation.
We have Maddie from Orlando. Hi, Maddie. Welcome to the program.
Hi there, Karen.
Hi.
I have a question for your guest. I have a pink Cassandra camellia. And it is beautiful. It's mounded. The leaves are a lustrous green. It's healthy looking. It has no insect problem, but it has never bloomed. What can I do?
It hasn't bloomed. I would want to look to see if it's getting too much shade. First off, camellias don't need heavy shade. They don't need to be on the north side of a house. That's a little bit too much shade. Under an oak tree is too much shade. So you would want to shade like what would be under a pine tree or full sun to about 10 or 11 o'clock in the summertime and then some shading. Camellias are light feeders and too much fertilizer inhibits flower bud formation as well. So you would want to go on the low side of the fertilizer recommendations and
What about a bloom booster? A phosphorus?
Bloom booster would help, yes, also. I would ask about the pruning techniques too, because if they are pruning into July, you know, later July, into August and September, there's a chance that you could be pruning the flowers off, the flower buds off. You won't see the flower buds in August, but unless you look hard, but they will, you know, you will begin to see them in September. So watch the pruning time. Don't over-fertilize. You can use a bloom builder type fertilizer. And Cassandra's full sun or light shade, Japonica's light shade.
Well, we got a quick one. Barbara from Orlando. Hi, Barbara. Real quick, what's your question today for Bill?
Hi, how far north beyond Florida do camellias grow and thrive?
The camellias that we grow here can grow throughout the Middle South, so there's no risk of freeze with camellias in Florida. Camellias can grow in Virginia, the Carolinas, Tennessee. They can eke into Kentucky. Some varieties of camellias can even be grown in Washington, D.C., New York City. But the camellias that you would obtain locally, there's no issue with freeze.
What about if it doesn't get cold enough? If we had a warm winter, will that impact flower buds?
That normally doesn't impact flower buds either. No. We've had no issues with flowering. Camellias are reliable flower producers in Central Florida.
Wow, that's terrific. Yeah. One last quick thing. How many times a year do you fertilize?
Since we soil incorporate fertilizer, we do fertilize, just when the plants are planted. And their production time in the nursery is about 18 months. So we do make a second application at the start of the 13th month. In the landscape, maybe twice, prior to bud break in the spring, and then maybe again in June. Follow the label directions on an azalea camellia fertilizer, and off you go.
Oh, my gosh. Well, that's all the time that we have, and I'd like to thank my guest, Bill Bodnarik, and thank you for joining in the program. Keep sending me your emails at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. There's always something new to learn about plants around us. Don't be afraid to get your hands dirty. Explore the outdoor frontier. But most of all, have fun doing it. That ends another season of Gardener's Hotline. So long.